though, just the usual average. Welcome to the Linux Users Group. As usual, we're getting a later start than what would be possibly desirable, but
that's all right.
It's on average, so we're not doing too bad. As was mentioned, if you want to chat with people randomly at all hours of the day, and maybe people might even respond to you, we do have an IRC channel that is, when it hasn't crashed, bridged over with a Slack instance. If you go to our website, now https://cialug.org, because now we've entered the new century and have security stuff, just follow the link to sign up for the mailing list and or join in the group text-based chat system. John, if you want to take it away, I guess.
Yeah, sure. So I forgot to put my name on the title slide, which, Sean Flattery, my name. I work at Principal, doing some security stuff. I do not have a programming background, so the stuff in here will be like not programming, and that's where my expertise falls short. So I also have no problems with like people interrupting me, so if you have a question or if you know more about something than I do and you want to share it, please share it. Like, I think this one is like a discussion.
Oh, no, I know all the things.
I
know everything.
All right, go. So yeah, I could, I think it's more of a discussion rather than like teaching, because I'm like Don, I do not know all the things. So kind of the idea for this talk is like, you get a file, you don't know what the heck this file is it good, is it bad, is it what it's telling you, like, you get an email and they say it's one thing, is it really that, or you get a free Windows installer or whatever, some garbage or the internet, you're like, well, is this safe, is it been backdoored, you might want to like, start plugging around with that, or maybe, you're trying to troubleshoot an error, like, why is this certain file in my environment not running properly? And we'll kind of figure out more about what's going on with that one too. So, WTF, what's that file? Topic, how to tell what a file is, if it's safe, and kind of get an idea of what it might do. So, caution, I do talk a little bit about Windows. Not much. A lot of stuff can be applied towards Windows stuff. I know we're in the user group, but it's, if you have a dangerous Windows file, you probably don't want to mess with it on Windows because it could run and then have the bad stuff happen. So if you're in a Linux environment, also a lot of the really cool file analysis tools are Linux based. So I'm kind of forced to use Linux for that, which is awesome.
Just be careful because Wine has been known to run viruses better than Windows.
Wouldn't you have to type in Wine first? You'd have to like consciously use Wine.
Don't do that. You'd have to launch new Wine and say, how would it run those?
So it's kind of the overall structure. Stack analysis and dynamic analysis. Static is like the file's not changing, dynamic is running. Dynamic analysis is dangerous unless you're doing it in a safe way. Dynamic analysis, magic numbers are not actually magic. This is the only GIF I have, so. There's no other cats in this presentation. Not actual magic, it is the like reserved hex or ASCII code at the start of the file. It denotes what kind of file it is. This is universal across Linux, Windows, Mac. Pretty sure Mac. And that tells you what it is, kind of what it does. There's file structures that each file type has to follow or should follow. And you can look all that reference material up if you want to get really in depth of it.
And I'm sure no one ever spoofs those at all, ever.
Yeah, so like, the image tragic vulnerability that was a few months back where you could take an image file and in the headers of the file you could put bash commands and you could potentially by having someone view that file, execute commands. So that's an example of putting stuff in headers that I'm supposed to do, right? Again, with pictures, you're taking a photo on your phone, you have this metadata, so you touch your camera IDs, and you get location on that, that's all like file headers like that too. So you don't want to
sort that stuff out. The exit
data? Yeah, the exit data. That's the official protocol format. But if you're to abstract that away from just JPEGs, you can find it to us. Cool way, if you just want to see the first bit of that, it's hexdump-C-N4 for the first 4 bytes. And the file name you're typing into, it'll spit out the beginning of that, both in hex and ASCII, because that's what the dash C will do. And you can see what kind of file it is. Or if you want it like, super easy and fast reading, you know, just type file and then like, I'll actually know what those are and do better than just saying like, oh, this is an ELF. Well, I don't know what an ELF is, right? This is a JFIF or it's a JPEG. They have all these like tables and files and they'll work out and all that. Top link for reference, by the way, I have a reference slide at the end too. But the top link is a great resource for basically the lookup table that file command will use. So you can, if file for whatever reason doesn't show the file, doesn't tell you what it really is, you have to look it up manually, you can go look it up there. Some files actually have a header, this one header. Footer structure at the very end tells you like, bam, right at the end of the file. Like, PDF actually does, I think, dash ELF in the file. Most files don't, which, if you're doing something like recovering a file off of a hard disk that's dying, it's a lot harder to figure out where the file stops. Some of the file headers will have stuff like this section is this many bytes long, and you need a map to figure that out. But it programs are doing stuff like that.
It also gives you a good reason to hide some stuff at the end beyond the PDF if you're looking for being sneaky.
Yeah. The PDF viewer won't be able to view it, you can pass that data off to the file. Absolutely. Yeah, the Wikipedia link is just saying what a magic number is. So. One of the more popular file formats, especially for Linux, is the ELF file structure, so I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in depth and some of the others. All the other ones are kind of all interesting. There's not as much to it, rather than this is what's coming next, and you get a blob of data. ELF is, that's your executable format. Really, that's equivalent to that EXE, stuff like that. So, ELF structure, it stands for executable and linking format. It's got a lot of information about what kind of file it is, like more for the operating system or the CPU. Which is something like, well, what's the architecture? Is it 32-bit, 64-bit? Is it ON? Is it Spark? That kind of stuff. It says if there's different dynamically linked objects that has to go and hold shared libraries to run that properly, which hopefully are in the right location on the hard drive. It says if the code is written begin means volume. You guys know if begin means volume, what that means? Is that what you're talking about? All right.
Call Native American, am I sure?
Yeah. So begin means long is like when you have data on a disk, you start from right and left in the disk. That's all it is. You might have heard it as least significant byte or most significant byte. It's similar like if you're getting data over a network connection, the TCP/IP stack knows the order of things, and so I can't remember which one it is, but it is definitively like the one of the things. It's like everything coming in from whatever channel. But computers need to know that kind of stuff because otherwise, like, you just don't know how this new file just comes in.
Well, that's machine language in there too, so as long as it doesn't know, but if it got confused or if they're trying to do a buffer overflow or some other script case trick,
yeah,
they would mess with the ELF file format to help it along in its nefariousness.
Yeah, and some of the things like what type of file is this, so how I know how to run it, of the operating system in New York, they're expecting that to be the location. And if it's not meant for the beginning, it's good for the end, but he tries to do something with the end of that video, which is an incarnation necessary enough so that all their important stuff. This is a really long, boring PDF, highly technical. Unless you think that's fun, I don't know. That's not important to me. But if you want to, like, give us amounts of data and I'll pull it out, there's that's a great technical resource for that.
It's a lot of papers.
Yeah. And it starts with an I and space and then the actual name of the book. Like the title page is all good stuff.
Well, it's got swords in it, by the way. Did you know that?
Swords.
L32 underscore sword, right here.
Oh. Yeah, that's for some.
Yeah, that's it's actually an S word or short word, but it's just a sword. So, yeah, L32, yeah, that's funny.
Yeah.
They snuck that little Easter egg in here.
I tried reading that document and why I was like,
oh, but do not include certain CPUs on there.
It's an old doc, too. Like,
oh, yeah.
Probably. Well, yeah, ELF binaries came into play like in the early pre-1 kernel days, I think.
Well, it's all like BSD based and something.
Oh, aggressive CPUs I've never seen lately.
People be reading documentation. They went through the effort of.
TLDR.
Ah, the good old guy.
Exactly.
So long ago.
Yeah, so after this, I'm going to do some commands specifically about files, but some other popular file types out there. This are like these multiple files jammed into one file, like a zip file, for example. Sometimes the file is packed. Or like a mine, like a multi-part file. So a lot of these things, like it sounds crazy, but they're actually really easy to look into. So everyone knows you gotta look at a zip file, but you can also unzip jar files, different types of Java stuff like origin and whatnot. And all of your XML-based office files can be unzipped.
Look in here.
Here is like an enterprise application jar file. It's like a bar.
It's just basically Java.
Yeah.
It was part of the Van Gogh virtual machine.
If anyone is more familiar, you can explain about it.
W archive and E archive, probably.
Yeah. I just know, like, you can throw in your Tomcat server.
W or E stands for it.
And this one has an open Tomcat server. I have, like, a shell.
For the office was purposely.
Yeah, yeah, that's the benefit of it, right? So from Microsoft Office 03 up or whatever, when they started, when they changed, they added like an X after everything that they have, like not putting forward, it was at all with OpenOffice and the Office and that stuff, just the OpenOffice format. And it's all XML based, so once you unzip that file, it's got some information about what is contained. And what files should be contained in there, and they have folder structures, and they have a whole bunch of XML. So you can just read that XML if you want. Or if you need to do automated transformations of Office documents, you don't have to open up your Office document in macro. You can actually say bash or something in the command line and unzip your Word doc, change what one word to another word, whatever you want to do, and then easily back up and that function.
Just as an aside, an ear is a bundle of water and jars.
Oh, geez.
So zipped on top of a zip.
So you take your jars and your wires and you stick them in your ear.
Yeah. By the way, Vim can open up, can view a zip file. That's really cool. You just do whatever file you want. Like normally in this case out in the jar file or whatever. And then it gives you like a file structure view and you just cursor up and down and when you want
it's like
the
a
next
browser.
Part. Yeah, it's like a browser. And you hit enter and bam, it opens up that part.
Sort of
could you try doing, like, reading it and then doing a write-out of that individual file straight to your file system, and then you just kind of have a convenient write-out, you know?
I don't know if you can.
Unless you can write it out. Unless you put W on it and put a path.
Yeah, because I don't, because it's compressed beforehand.
Right, but see, since it's decompressed in memory, so if you bring up on your screen, show it to your right straight out of the file.
You mean like that pulling W, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, and then if you do that, unless
you're going to write back to the same file.
It could.
But you could write, well, I don't know if it will let you do that. That needs to be inserted too.
If that jar file has a CRC, which it probably does, you know, cause you.
Yeah, but I'm thinking just write it out to a separate place for
yeah.
You having it out there decompressed for whatever other purposes.
Yeah, yeah, you could definitely do that.
Yeah, so you want to say.
Yep.
Can I just save as?
PPWT?
PowerPoint.
But PowerPoint PPWT as.
Yeah, I was wondering
about that. That's probably showing some, but just.
Might be an older format,
maybe? No, well, that's probably just me misremembering.
No, actually, it's from Windows 10. It needs to wait. Go to the next slide.
Good catch. yeah. And MIME files are usually used for transferring something to the internet and transferring like a bunch of files together. It was designed initially for email, but if you wireshark to the traffic, like you can see these files for stuff. So if you have a PCAP with subphone on, you can see this weird data. You'll have like MIME, it'll say MIME headers, and it has separators in between each file. And it's pretty clear in the text of it. You can then carve out the individual parts within that, and then save those to the file and cover the individual files after that. Which I've had before.
In terms of being animated, yeah, like that.
And then you get really disappointed, you're like, damn it, I thought there was something like the secret or something. And it's just for Java stuff, instead of actually on Zivia, there's a couple of specialized programs you can do too. GDB is an awesome Vue-based program that'll let you have your Go app, and Jazz is the command line version. And then for .NET people, DNSpy is awesome. Super awesome. So .NET, like Java, is pre-compiled. Oh, no, sorry. Like partially compiled to code,
or like Java.
Yeah, it's not exactly source code, but it's not compiled. It's compiled runtime. So the cool things with like Java and .NET code is you can see comments.
Really?
Yeah.
So put the comments in
with it. Yep. So if they do something like come back and fix this section later, and then you know whatever do it, like you can see. What sometimes up with passwords?
Ship it?
No. You can actually
ship it no matter what.
You can go a step further than that and reverse compile it back into source code.
Yeah. When I use DNSpy and GDGUI, it looks like source code, like the original source thing. It's probably, yeah, you know better than I do, but like, it's scary how close. It's enough that I can get all sorts of secrets out of it, like private keys and passwords and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
private keys and passwords, like what, for databases or something?
Applications.
Okay. So
yeah, database too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That is really, yeah, that would be.
Fun times.
Yes.
You can copy that.
We know about it.
Yeah. It's one of those like necessary evils almost. There are some safer ways of doing it, but it's not.
What, say the passwords?
Well, the password part, but like certificates. At some point, if an application needs a password, it's going to have a way of getting that password.
Oh, yeah.
And it has to get it clear somehow. At some point.
Yeah. A higher speed.
So right in the real line.
You're not wrong. Yeah, there's a lot of
people be approved
for that stuff.
So here's some commands more specific to ELF files. Binutils or distro specific version that should be installed by default. Usually hackutils doesn't seem to be, and that has a couple of the extra utils in there. Binutils more useful. Readelf, pretty awesome file in there. This is just a tiny, tiny bit of a massive amount of data that will readelf will spit out. Readelf-A will do all the file. You can do parts. I have all sorts of associates for individual parts. As you see, it's got the magic number and hex up here, and then I'll actually say more about it down there. This is a lot of the beginning of that. There's the problems. And they have your different sections, like your different libraries, your shared objects, your text sections, data sections, stuff like that. But you can, some of these programs you can use to decompile to, for the show it's in the assembly code. There are better programs to use in these ELF tools. If you just run, like, readelf, enter the --help, this is all the crazy numbers I can do. You can run strings against part of that, too, if I remember right.
So you pipe strings in there?
No, it's built in for me. One of these guys. It's on my preserve notes, which I can't see right now.
I feel like I'm not missing security in the preserve notes.
ODB tree is another cool program, so it shows you all the Linux libraries. So if you're in dependency hell and you don't know why a certain program won't work anymore, you can run a tree on it and try to figure out what's looking for and what that means and where to work. Also, if you get like some weird ELF file that you can like malware and you want to know kind of an idea of what it might do, like can talk out on the network. You can touch stuff on the disk in the files, like seeing what kind of libraries it's loading will give you a clue just to send the capabilities that might have. Dump ELF will give you pseudo C code of what it thinks it might be reconstructed that is C code. So it'll kind of dump all that stuff out. Again, it's just like a truncated part that I'm showing here. You can see the header files, things, actually the header files you should know, but things it's not going to know are like comments, custom function names, stuff like that. So that's all stripped of compile. Again, I think there's some better ways if you really get in depth about doing what you think the original code might have been. It'd be more like using viewing in assembly. Or a debugger, but this is at least a very safe way to just output some text and go up things and things from that. Object dump is another cool one that I have not used a whole lot, but you can dump different parts of the ELF file itself out. This is the one that disassembles. Yeah, sorry, we don't.
Object dump
disassembles? Object dump? OBG dump? Yeah. So again, this would not be the disassembler I'd recommend. And it's built in. So sometimes, like, if you don't have access to install other things, you can't get the file off that system if you actually do. Can do debugging as well. So, although I'd recommend GDB. And scanelf, I think this one's on the PyX utils. This will allow you to scan your system for ELF files and for various characteristics of the ELF files. So if someone's taken over your computer and you're like super paranoid and worried and maybe they've replaced some of your binaries, this might help figure some of that stuff out. You can like searching for permissions, looking for like a modified gate, you can print file sizes for that. So you can search everything in depth. It'll also show all your shared objects that are on the system. So again, if someone's trying to replace them, it might be longer, depending on how well you manage your system. Or you can potentially compare that to like a golden engine system, like super. it has this dash dash fix. I don't know what that does. It sounds cool. I saw some article online with like a programmer had this weird touch there that someone was trying to write. And they're like, well, if you use scale, you can show these things. And the dash fix would try to fix it on that. Yeah, so there's some non-alt specific commands. Of course, file's awesome, very easy to use. You can tell, like, it's the file I ran it on, it's an ELF, it's 64-bit, significant bit, or...
Byte, it's byte. Capital D equals byte, small lowercase is bit. And the library that we're using for loading.
I wonder if this is the file server, the hash of it.
That looks a lot like, the SHA-1.
It's SHA-1 at the other
side. SHA-1, so it's a SHA-1 script.
I think I have a SHA-1 another slide right after this. So. Hexdump again. I really like Hexdump. Handline use that if you have a GUI available, there's a lot better extenders out there. But it's got the actual hex code of the file here that you can view, and then they try to represent an ASCII. You can see a lot of dots. The dots are non-displayable characters. And if you're dealing with Unicode text, there's actually dots in between each letter. So if you try to run strings on it, it doesn't pull that out unless you in a dash EL in your strings.
Dash what?
EL.
For the extended length or something? Yeah, for Unicode code?
Yeah, essentially for Unicode. The help files is something like that, a bit length, I think, but it's essentially for Unicode. So if you're running strings in something, run it once the normal way, and then again, the EL, so you can see that it's Unicode.
So strings out of EL.
Or
Unicode.
On Windows, there's a system kernel string that's programmed on both. Oh, kind of JavaScript. Yeah, that is that shot sum. It's a different kind of sum that's up there. We did file before. You know what? That's the same as the file command. That is not the author strings. I
mean, yeah.
Yeah, what is that?
That's the same output as the file command.
When did you finish up this?
Huh?
When did you finish preparing this?
Like an hour and a half ago.
We can forgive if you miss commands.
Yeah, it's probably the SHA one.
It says SHA one in the bracket there.
Yeah. Well, but, yeah, for the build ID, the SHA-1 equals some other, it's probably that. Yeah. This is for the Lens program, so anyone who's logged in the Lens right now can just type that out and find out.
I hope it's so what you're trying to accomplish with that strings that you were trying to do, or?
Was
that supposed to be a file?
Just to show the strings.
Yeah,
the
strings shows all the different,
characters
that you can find. This is my work laptop, that's why it's in there.
Burn him! Burn him!
Heretic!
You cannot read that.
After security.
Strings, all I see is little dots.
Please switch to analog, Sean, so that we can't see any pixels whatsoever. We all make good smush.
So we'll do strings on. Yep, so I'm spring out all the strings that are down that program, which that part doesn't seem super useful.
You can run through sort and then do dash u, and it helps a little bit.
Yeah, the strings are generally going to be all unique. There shouldn't be a reason that those strings pop up a whole bunch of
times. You can, though.
Yeah.
If you do just a straight sort, you'll see the duplication on stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, you're gonna get a lot, leave a few.
The other thing that I like doing is, so strings by default will look for a string of 4 characters or more, and a whole lot of that is garbage. So if you just type in like dash and the number you want it to do, it'll say, so this is for dash, it's 6 characters, right? 5 or 6 seems to be, for me, like a more of a sweet spot between levels of garbage and ultimate usefulness. Yeah, so this will give you all the plain text strings.
Showing the words 2 and 3. Because there's spaces.
Oh.
Spaces are exception strings, I believe. That would explain it. Why do you still do a sort on that? If I could just sort for a second and see if you get duplication.
Yeah, I can do that in a sec. But so within these strings, like, why would you want to do strings was a question, right? So you could see in here, like, if it's using unsafe commands in there, like stir copy, that's known for buffer overflows. So if you want to break in, that's for create a buffer overflow in a short program. Or, like, let's say if you think it's malicious, you want to know what the heck it's doing, you pull these strings out, and you get an idea.
Especially if you think you see words like only PIMA or something like that, you know.
It's usually IP addresses, right? So you can get the IP address, you can look it up online, see like where the heck it's going to go into it. You see a whole bunch of IRC commands, and now it's another CBOT. I can show you a real malicious file if that's some good stuff there too, if you guys want. So
I can use wine.
Only if you want it. Yeah, so since this is like a real, actual good file, yeah.
There's some duplication there.
Yeah, but that's all garbage. That's not actual.
Yeah, but if you do sort dash u, then you'll get it.
Yeah.
You don't want it there.
On a real file, you're going to see stuff like error messages. So it's a good tip. If you're looking at a file with no error message, it's either encrypted and you can't see it, or it's not a good file.
Yeah, we just shot one on the side.
Okay.
Or at least it was the same number of bytes as a shot one on the side, which means it's a shot one on the side.
Yeah, I didn't know if it was of that file, or if it's part of it or not.
I don't know on that. My less command was a different shot. But.
Well, run the file against yours, and then compare the your shot one on to look.
That build, that distro
was going to be different.
Yeah, binary.
Shaw
than me. It should be. Yes. I mean, that would be expected versus what it had along the way.
So,
and if you set sort of
dash U.
Dash U, then you, yeah. You know, I think pipe it, yeah. Well, that's interesting.
Huh.
Some of those are different.
Well, this dash user, you should never get any redeems.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you see a scroll limit. You see the scroll limit go back? That's interesting. Now from less. Long lines. You leave any more numbers?
Yeah, well, this is the less file.
I know.
But yeah, that gives you an idea. So what the other.
Readwoodsoftware.com. There you go.
So again, legit file, they often have something like this in it. So if you get this mystery binary, you don't know what it is, you can pull out stuff like that and look it up online and then figure out what that file is. I think it's OpenSSL or libSSL in it, especially for Windows anyways, where if you have a program that uses SSL encryption, they package those libraries into it or they build it into that. And then they have some of the copyright information on it too. Or the original author's name.
Yeah, it's OpenSSL copyright.
Or copyleft, or whatever. Like,
GNU.
Yeah, we have the licensing. The licensing stuff, thank you. It's not bad. So you can oftentimes figure out the licensing information, like a must license, and then figure out either what it's packaged with or what the actual program itself is and what it does. Another thing that popular legitimate programs do is they often sign the application. And that file, that signature, which is like a certificate from the CA, that's going to be at the very end of your file, for sure.
So you can look that up and
yep.
manually
Maybe they were like, not have company name.
Would it be an MD5 or what?
No, it's like Plaintext, like all the very end, to show the text details of the signature. Yes, there is some kind of CRC checking that happens that I think shows how it happened.
Yeah, which is used in the integrator.
Right, but as far as like detective work, especially in this file, so that the very end, so you actually see that.
But when you sign a file, isn't there like a checksum of that file embedded in the signature itself?
Yeah.
So then you verify that that signature is correct.
You don't actually do that way.
And compare that against, well, if you're doing it manually, though.
Yeah.
You'd have to pull that all out and verify it manually.
Yeah. Like, in Windows anyways, I know you need to go like file properties and you look at that, that tab, but it will tell you what it is. So, strings is awesome to use. I mean, you can look at hex dump and you can do that yourself too, but strings is really cool. And then you've got, you buy some shop sums, I assume most people know about those. MD5 sums are not technically secure anymore. Should be using something stronger. Technically, SHA-1 sums are a government agency could enforce them. Somebody with that much computing power, yet we couldn't, but a nation still could.
A really big credit card in Amazon.
If you want to spend, you know, thousands and thousands of dollars, yeah.
Well, they might have got a good card.
And it might take you like a month of processing time. But yeah, it's possible. So a lot of the stuff online though, the people that posted haven't done in the past, they use MD5. MD5 is also a lot faster to do. And if you're just looking at this file with tamper, like most people don't care about the theoretical grammar collision in the MD5 setting. It would be really, really hard to manipulate a file, how to keep the same thing by itself, and how to work into something useful. So people still use MD5 for purposes. The good thing I can do, like if you want to know if that file is what it is, or if it's been tampered with, you can take that, go into Google, just be searching for that. Also, if you're downloading a file from somewhere, oftentimes the distributor will have that sum listed, so you can carry that. And virus totals, people heard of virus total a little bit. So, if you haven't before, if it's awesome, not amazing, not like that. There are flaws in it, but if you want to throw any file against like 50 different DB programs, you can do that. Hopefully. File then goes to all the antivirus vendors and you look at whatever file you have, and anyone who pays, it's owned by Google by the way, anyone who pays Google to have an API key for it can download it and lock it.
I don't
think
they charge for that.
I don't know. Actually, it's not just an API key, it's because you can get a free file upload API key that's rate limited, but then you can get it by an unlimited version and not allow you. I haven't seen prices for it, but usually it's like corporations buy it. So there's
you have an insurance company?
I don't know. I don't know every single insurance company whether or not they buy their company. But there's other programs like Carbon Black, host-based intrusion protection programs that they can take these files and put them in the virus total and see if they're good or bad. That's a bad idea to blindly upload files, especially in a corporate environment. That you're just essentially giving them out to everyone in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's really good when the document's more confidential.
Yeah. So a safe way of doing that is take your MD5 sum or draw some of the file and search virus total with it.
Oh, However, if you were trying to do double click against your competitors, you could pick a false document and upload it to virus.
Yeah. Your competitors probably will not have access to virus. Normally, you open millions of files.
I was saying,
you could.
You could, you know, like.
At that point, just like drop the USB in the parking lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, but then I think, you know, this is more, you know.
With your company's logo on it.
Secret team at times.
That's some bright malware or ransomware.
So, you can't hover throw stuff up to the virus, so if you're confident that it's not sensitive. Like, if I receive a random email from someone I've never heard of before outside of my company, like sending a file attachment, I will upload that back. Because at that point, they probably shouldn't send it to me. but otherwise, you know, probably shouldn't do it. If you're not familiar with Fire Soul, I recommend just playing with it for a minute. There's a lot of cool stuff that After Analysis the file can tell you about. It does some of this by analysis. Stuff we've been talking about. Also, antivirus is a very imperfect solution that is delayed. So, if you throw something up there and you're like, hey, nobody or only 1 out of 50 thinks it's bad, or thinks it's, yeah, it must mean it's good, right? Mm-hmm. They don't know that it's bad.
Maybe you're the first?
Well, I've been the first oftentimes on that kind of a thing. I've helped crack some virus signatures in the past. You can create an infinite amount of virus. Like, you take like your one bad file you have and you just run a table endlessly. And that guy's here a long time ago, but they can do that and bypass all these signatures. And it's such a flood of the same but slightly different power.
They call it polymorphic.
That's a different approach, though. That's the program itself morphs, which is harder to do. But these are the guys like they just create a bunch of different versions of the same thing and they ship off as far as they
can. Oh, so like script KB plus dev random?
Yeah.
I mean, that would be the other way I describe it, so it's not true polymorphic.
Yeah, no, you're exactly right. That's all it is. They even have little word builder applications.
They call it VAAS, virus as a service.
Yeah, there are actual. Every part of the bad guy infrastructure can be done as a service.
RAAS, ransomware as a service.
Yeah, this is just an example of the file. There's this other guy who's awesome. I think his name is D.A.? Yeah, I don't know.
Oh.
His last name is Stevens, first name is whatever that
means. It's a French guy.
Yeah. I think he might be Dutch? Anyway, European. And he's written a ton of awesome stuff. He's in the SAND and Storm Center, and he updates tools constantly. If you got a weird office file, he's written all sorts of parsers. He has like tutorials of how to do it and everything. Really cool, awesome stuff. It'll strip out all different parts of those office files. It'll pull out so things that Antivirus is bad at, which is detecting office docs right now, like this thing will do. It will give you information to make the determination about an apps right now.
You're in Brussels, Belgium.
Belgium, awesome. Yeah, so loadydump.py is office ones and PL parsers for anyone else.
What?
Yeah, JavaScript.
You said you didn't mind getting interrupted.
No.
Now you're regretting it.
I'm not. It's good.
Stop chasing squirrels. Back on topic.
But if you interrupt, just share so everyone can hear it.
Making fun of Belgium.
They're awesome.
Chocolates are pretty killer. Basically, it's a food hedonist porn zone.
Do you think they're in trouble with your
kids? Where do you think my
sister's? Why do you think that they put the European Union in Brussels? Not because they were sprouting something fresh. It was self-referential, what it was.
Moving on. Okay. Definitely move on now.
Spider Monkey uses JavaScript. And I think it'll like run it from the command line too as it goes through it, so it won't actually use like infect your browser. JavaScript's often used to web pages to mess stuff up, so I'm tired of that. So that's what he's got. So many cool things. He's a really sharp guy. He's got tutorials and like screencasts to how to use things. Dynamic analysis. This is quite a lot shorter. So, sandboxes is the best way to do dynamic analysis. You can build one your own, and then have all sorts of monitoring tools to see like what changes. That's a lot of work. You then have to remember to reset your image every single time you want to do something different. And you have to have effective controls, so like if you have a network one and you run it, it doesn't just actually go out to the rest of your network and do stuff. There's also the challenge of a lot of these malware authors have detections for running sandboxes, and these people are fighting that cat and mouse battle, so you don't have to.
I won't execute my payload.
Yeah, or like, do I have a network connection? Let me ping Google first. And if I can't get out to Google, then I just don't run the rest of the script anymore. There's a lot to it. Cuckoo is a free one, open source, and you can run in your own environment, and that way when you're uploading a file to it, it doesn't go out public to the rest of the internet. Then you can do whatever. So that's a good resource if you want to run something sensitive and see what happens. The analysis is output on the web page, so it's very becoming easy to use. And I remember it keeps historically all the different files you can run on it. For public ones, malware, or malwr.com, it used to be pretty cool, and it was mostly a cuckoo sandbox of the public, so you didn't actually have to manage it yourself. It's been down, coming back soon for months, so who knows. But the one that I really, really like is Hybrid Analysis, which is like a giant. I think you can run like 100 a month from the same IP or something like that, new submissions. Anyone can download it without needing to pay money too. So if you want to look at bad stuff and mess with it, like you can just go quickly and find that out there. We have a submissions section that's on the top of the main page. So you can pull that stuff down and look at it. I linked an example report. You can really just find anyone out there from their submission page and look at it. It's fantastic the amount of stuff that they do. They'll run it in their sandbox environment. They'll capture screenshots of it every so often and capture PCAPs of everything that happens, which I think you can download. They show you what the network connections are, like the app requests and stuff like that. They show you, I don't know, like the files that it touches on the system and registry keys that it changes. It also has some behavioral signatures, like if you touch the registry, that is a signature. It doesn't mean it's bad, because every program that runs technically does touch the registry. Forensics can say, like, you go from this folder and you go to this program, so it touches the registry. But if it adds a new registry entry, that's a little more suspicious. There's a whole bunch of bunches different things. So if you get enough of these things, you're like, oh, now you probably have that. So they do that in addition to also sending that data over to VirusTotal and reporting back to you.
Reporting to VirusTotal for free, huh?
It just saves you the steps.
Right, but that's like a save time.
Yeah, absolutely. Although it takes longer to do hybrid analysis than VirusTotal. Like a lot longer.
That'd be useful out of seed company.
Useful in a lot of places. The other cool thing is, they do limit you by IP, but they sell you a product that you can install on your own. I think they have a cloud version too, so you don't have to install, you just pay. We found out they had it on it because of toys, like, hey, you guys got some, you know, celestial magic that's not. And I think their licensing model last time it was good to pay per submission, which could get expensive.
Really?
But they changed their model a couple of times. But it's a really cool free thing, especially good if I, five times a month, you get some crazy email, and they don't know if the house is occupied. You can throw it there. So Sandbox is a safe way to write stuff, and compare all it does. There's debuggers and compilers. GDB or Gnome Debug is a great family one for Linux. This does run code. So if you're not sure if it's good or if it's safe to run code, don't do that unless you're in a Sandbox.
well, I thought there's run code
environment that with your hard drive is attached to, you know. Yeah, Visual Studio Code is another one for your .NET stuff. help you debug it. The decompilers will take the binary to show you actual assembly language machine code and what the processor would do. And you see it's a lot harder to understand what the hell is going on unless you're an ASIL assembly, which you're not.
JetBrain does have some stuff that will actually spit into real-ish looking code.
Yeah, more of the IDEs are starting to have some of these features to help. You can set like breakpoints and then debug into. You can step through individually, see what happens. You can look at the memory of what the program is. You know, pretty powerful features. I think it greatly helps have a program background in these installs. There's a few more popular decompilers out there. I'm not sure how to pronounce it. Radar? Or two, Radari 2, whatever it is. That one is free and starting to get more popular. It's kind of fairly recent. It runs off of VMI. IDA Pro is the pro version, which is not free. And then there's a free version of it as well that is like a few months behind and has some of the features behind the paywall. But that one is the industry standard. Some of your software and stuff like that. And I read some article about, yeah, this hacker like figured out that there's some flaw in the garage door opener and if they said this, like this specific place, there's a hard coded backdoor credentials that we use in the garage door back. Hopper is another one that, while not free, is affordable. I think it's like $90, whereas IDA Pro. Pay for it. Several thousand.
That's pretty common for a high-end or a tool like that.
Yeah.
There's some other stuff like that that's all in that high price category, not for the pedestrian or normal.
Well, but the pedestrian part of that though, you can have the free Wi-Fi.
Okay, so they have like a.
Yeah.
So it's got, I'm sure it's got some cutoff on how much it'll do for you.
No, it's just features that are probably locked.
Okay, yeah. There you go.
And then as they introduce a new feature, it goes to the paid version first and then like trickle down more as well.
Okay.
But still, it's a fantastic program. Very powerful. There's lots of plugins and modules you can get for it too.
You want to swap?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Okay.
Your garage door opener example made me think of the link I had in today. About a program that will output AM radio from any of our PCs. Just run the code. And I'm very curious, I did not have time. I wanted to get here on time and listen to you, but.
So it turns your PC into a software AM radio.
Yeah.
Basically.
We could look at it later.
And that's a lot of I mean, yeah. And the point was to prove, hey, your air gaps aren't as secure as you think they are.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because you programmed, this was like those guys that did this, the you know, switching a data center to get data out thing with air gaps, too.
Yeah, air gaps, like, unless you have like a giant concrete 360 degree barrier around your computer.
You want to know, you want a Faraday cage.
Well, that's, I'm sorry, concrete with a Faraday cage, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Full enemy of the state with detonation option.
They can do things like, like if you put your cell phone down next to your keyboard and you start typing the keyboard, the cell phone can measure the vibrations and hear what you're typing.
Vibrations and sound, yeah.
Yeah. Not even the sound, just the vibration from the accelerometer. Yeah, like this crazy stuff. There's
well,
so
much
more radio points. Oh yeah, the last link is just a reference doc for all the assembly code functions, so if you're messing around with that, you want to know what that means, you know, there's an ops and shelf.
So there's another thing too, if you go up a level on his thing with his GitHub,
yeah.
He's got something called Interpilot, turn an interpreter into a code generator.
For that
other guy?
Yeah.
Computes or?
Yeah, you're using the Xcode project file setting up as a part of it.
Right? Yeah.
So it's basically, oh, one of the folders is called BrainPy.
Is that programming language?
It's an LLVM interpreter into code generator combo of some sort. So it's kind of, this is really funky stuff and a little bit of language stuff.
Yeah.
He calls it Interpilot. So it's like
transpile from EXE to, or executable to some other language.
It looks kind of like that, yeah. I mean, it's kind of interesting little turn an interpreter into a code generator. That was like, yeah, that's kind of a fun little like concept. Let's twist your mind up.
Yeah, I think for brain fog, it's like the least amount of instructions possible, like something stupid, like 10 different possible instructions you have to try to.
Well, that's actually designed for getting your head wrapped around RISC instruction sets, which is reduced instruction set, versus what that big list for the x86, that's complex instruction set computers, i.e. x86, and there's a lot there. And then if you look at old CPUs like 8085 and 6502, they only had, they were 8 bits, so they top out 256, you know, so and maybe like overlap with modes and stuff, so you actually have much fewer. So they have 10, and then Suite 16 was the pseudo machine code that Steve Wozniak used with Apple II. That was kind of interesting, that we did way back when they could not have to sit through measuring and mod code, so it was doing hand assembly.
Yeah, well, if you want to see like what the CPU would get those kinds of instructions as, use a little tool like that to actually break it down into the CPU instructions.
That's the way you actually want to use.
Yeah. And so this is like the process flow of the program. So we'll come in here and like either go over here or there based on the output of that function. Like, so you can do a string in there. If it's this, go here, and it's that, go there. Did the user press a one or
that's
two?
That's a nice diagram.
Yeah, so it diagrams everything out and all the functions. And you can see loops too, because the loop would then like just come back into itself unless you kind of use it properly. So it's another visual way of trying to understand what the heck this program is trying to do, trying to figure out what it's about. So that's just it's for IDA Pro. Some of the other ones are similar, have stuff like that too. And there's a bunch of other, each one of those tabs is an extra function. Yeah, that's it. So, got some references. We'll send a link out over email.